My talk is about anti-patterns in OpenOffice. It's basically anti-patterns you find everywhere. Yeah. So let's see what I talk about. I tell you a bit who I am, what I want to do with this talk, what are anti-patterns in general, if you didn't heard it till now, and then we look at four anti-patterns exemplary that I have chosen that I could find or I think they are in OpenOffice. They're concerning to different development practices or disciplines, programming, yeah, methodological styles or ideals, project management. Yeah, also open source does have project management, not only closed source, and software design stuff. So, oh, yeah, for the people on the on the video, there are two slices. One is not as detailed, splitting the slides. I split the slides quite often, so I do not overestimate the people so bit. So, who I am? My name is Peter Kovac. As a profession, I'm an IT consultant for ETL systems. I usually work with big data stuff. For more than 10 years, I use privately open source since 2004. And since September 2016, I joined the OpenOffice community to improve OpenOffice. Yeah, so as you see, I'm not really an application developer, but someone who usually moves big amount of data around for companies. So while I move big data around for companies and for big ones, not really small ones, I find anti-patterns always. And funny thing is, I find them in open source as well. So anti-patterns are common. Just keep that in mind. And even I have not told you what an anti-pattern is, but we will look at what people do or did. We will assume what might have happened. But it's not to bash people. It's very important for me. It's bash the code. Yeah? There's something not very well done with the code, and it happens always. Even if you go for best faith, if you're trying to do something very good, at some point you don't have time, you want to shortcut or something, and then you use an anti-pattern because it's usually the dark force of the side of coding. And my goal is for this talk that you are aware about bad designs, anti-patterns, or what not to do, or that you have done it, and maybe keep in mind that you will return to that part of code and try to find a better solution. So what are anti-patterns in general? Anti-patterns are ways to develop something that have proven to not be very good. So we do not focus on what worked, we focus on what hasn't worked for various reasons. In methodological patterns, we look at abstract ideas, stuff that we have stuff that we know from development science or software science, how do you call it, that we learn actually in school or university or something. Programming patterns are steps, development steps or programming steps we use in order to achieve a goal, and the anti-pattern is it works, but it will get back to you at some point in future. Software designs is when you have an overall idea how to your program is structured, but yeah, well, it is maybe sounds good, but it doesn't work out. Project management pattern is usually has nothing to do with coding at all, but with organization in all around what you do, in the corporation or in the cooperating way. And this is really also not so, usually not so much in focus in open source, but more in companies, but it's also there in open source. So let's look at one methodological pattern. My anti-pattern of choice is copy and paste. Who hasn't done it? We have here some actual code out of Trunk from OpenOffice. The code is not important for me so much, but let's go a little bit through. We have a template of some sort, yeah? So we can reuse this steps of code by just modifying this variables in this fat, in this bold typed thing. The underline stuff is the function we will get. Then this boost desic assert is some quality checking. Then we have here a code line and a return statement that we will have. This green marked statement is important because right next to it, we have the same function almost. I mean, there's some differences, small differences, but believe me, it does almost the same. So especially this one here and this one here, the green parts are really the same. So my assumption is that because this code is used and we do not know maybe what is the real impact, we do not have time to research this or we are not interested in researching it. So we just place this almost the same part of code by copying it next to it and use that instead for our new stuff we want to do. And yeah, maybe at some times this one will be dead code and we want to delete it or whatever. But basically we have parallel usage of the same stuff. And you might think in the long run this will come back to us because we could have get that code, so no one is not really knowing what this code does and is quite unsure what to fix or what to change. And the other one is, yeah, maybe also that it's not so clear what to do next or so on. So in case you just don't believe me, it's the same. Introvert position is this sign off. This sign off you find here. Yeah, this is also a piece of code which is above the code. And the bit mask is also there, which has been put here. Yeah? So it's really, really, really the same. So Jetzt look at the next stuff. Still the same code. Cargo cult programming. I like to use that when I learn a new feature. And then I use it always. Always. If it does make sense or not, I use it just to train me to get an experience when it works, when it doesn't work. I think this happened here. Because this guy really, or this piece of code, really loves templates. We have these two codes. We just have a steep look at it, which provides us a function. These functions are used in this class here, which is a pack pixel column iterator. Then we get the next template with row iterator. And as the last one, we have the iterator itself, which can do both. Now, yeah, this is really fancy. If you order our code only using templates, we can really put a puzzle together and just puzzle what fits and what fits together or not. But in software development, we have, or especially in C++, we have more ways to program it, to make it better, to make it readable. Yeah, we could have a program iterator or pixel packed pixel class that can work with a row iterator and a column iterator. Yeah, and we just load the special iterator we just need for our special case. We could integrate this function in here because it's all also the same as we have seen it. So it would get very much readable. And templates we have used do not help really because they opaque us what the code really does to us. So it's really difficult for the next volunteer, developer, or worker, coworker to understand what you did. He has to phone you, has to write you a mail or whatever, to just understand what you did. Let's move on to the software design pattern. I choose the big ball of mud. I actually find that very funny. What is it? It's about you have a big software and you do not know really where something is. I picked something from a layout from OpenOffice. I think it's very old, but it's still accurate, I think. And now we have folders in OpenOffice where we have different modules, where we find our code. And let's just try to figure out where in our software model these modules fit. Yeah, Siri, I don't know what it does, but I find it here. It's not very speakable. Yeah, it's a little bit obvious, but it's. I could get an imagination what it really does if I dig into it here now. Yeah. So. Yeah, I think, yeah, okay, sounds good. No big ball of mud, maybe. P, you know, P, okay, I assume it with Python somehow. You know, I find here and here. I know what you know is. It comes, it's a word in, it's a defined word in open office development. So you have a good idea what it may be, what I might be finding it. So also no ball of mud where I do not know what it does or where I have to put that to. SC. SC is a lot difficult. Has anyone an idea where what SC could be in this screen? Yes, StarOffice, very old, and Calc we have here, Okay. But we also need a little bit to know about the history already, yeah? So, because StarOffice is not part anymore of OpenOffice, yeah? That's history. Or LibreOffice, for that sake. Sullhyper. Yeah, now it gets difficult. Yeah, for me, as a new developer, it's really difficult where to put that. I put that here, but I'm not really sure. Yeah? EPM? Yeah. Yeah. I have no clue. Yeah? This is a potential candidate for a big ball of mud. It does something, it's opaque to you, and you do not know where to put it. If you look into it and it gets clear, maybe not, but on the first glance, it's difficult to put it somewhere. So, from my perspective, I would say we are probably have some balls of mud around in the code, and who wonders at 100,000 lines of code? I mean, your LibreOffice developers face the same challenge. Yeah, I bet. I read once, as a heroic effort, we reduced code by 90% at one place, somewhere in a LibreOffice changelog, which is really good. Avoids big ball of mud, I think, or other anti-patterns. And the last one I want to present today is the Death March. The Death March is, let's look at Wikipedia, where you can find lots of anti-pattern that you can look out for. The general feel of the project reflects that of an actual death march because project members are forced to continue the project by their superiors against the better judgment. So, in open office, we usually do not have so much hierarchy, but maybe if you work in a company and your boss says, hey, that's a good idea, follow it, go it, and you're not behind that idea, you do not have any commitment for it. It's really annoying, and you are on a death march. You could also have this in open source. Because when the community says, yeah, yeah, keep going, keep going, keep going, but you do not want to keep going. I mean, you've done your share, you want rather to go out with your girlfriend or something, but everyone says, yeah, here, you're a contributor, keep going, yeah? You're also on a death march. Avoid this. It just makes everything suffer, I think. So, this is my short walkthrough through anti-patterns and what I could find or could think of in OpenOffice. The last one, of course, we had that some years ago where people quit because they said, hey, I can't go any further. Yeah, I don't follow you. And it's okay. It's really okay. And to step up and say, no, I can't do it, keeps courage. Have courage, people. Yeah. Any questions? Or do you have idea how to avoid anti-patterns in your project? Would you stand up for people and say, hey, friend, you have, I read your code just for interest. And it doesn't look good. Now you have arguments why it maybe not, maybe doesn't look good. Yeah? Undependents are really experienced when they do not look.
The big problem I see with fixing coding anti-patterns in OpenOffice is the lack of unit tests. To safely recode something,
yeah,
just to make it prettier.
It's really
my own Java code. If a function exists, a unit test exists. And so changing the implementation is safe because I can go and check that it still behaves the way it's supposed to. I don't have that in OpenOffice.
No, often not. But often, these for example, if you have a lot of copy and paste or the template stuff you've seen in the beginning, it's difficult to write a test against that the new code does the same what the old code does. The people who have written it are long gone. Yeah, maybe it's the third or fourth generation. I looked it up for the for this code. Since the code is in at Apache, there have been no change in that part. They have no changes be done. So that code has been from Oracle times or Sun times or even older, maybe from where StarOffice was just StarOffice. Yeah. So we have that, and this is really difficult to approach to change it. But you have to at least make a note that you have to change it at some point. Yeah.
It's been stable for a couple of decades. Why should I change it?
Because you cannot maintain it.
But I don't need to maintain it if it's been doing what it's supposed to do for the last 20 years.
Do you know it? Yes?
My English is not that perfect, so maybe so forgive me if I can't say it to one person. But I think the issue is what the verses. What you want is make it stable, but you have lots of stuff that does the job, and you just keep letting it doing it, or just to keep you reduce the footprint of the application and don't keep the history that you have kept for years. And your pattern is that what you want to keep it, you want to do it what it does, and don't change it if you need. And he says the opposite. He says just clean it up. It's like you have a room full of books, and he says here just we have to clean it up, and you want to make it as it is. And I think there's a balance between it. If you have the time, it's needed. That sometimes it gets not tidy.
Yeah, I know it's not tidy.
Yeah. I don't think we argue for the camera. The argument was we have to find a balance between tidying stuff, tidying code up, and leave it as is because there is no issue in it. And this is a question we always have to ask. But if you change something, yeah, this is the message, and you see why you are changing, or your colleague or friend or whoever sees that what you do will fall back, and at some point it's really difficult to change, as we have it now in OpenOffice. Yeah, we have a lot of anti-patterns, and it's really difficult to change because we cannot verify it. If it's still then doing some effect, and we change little things, and they have really big impacts throughout the code, because we cannot overlook it. It really gets very, very difficult. So avoiding anti-patterns in the beginning is much more worth than fixing it later up.
Oh, yes.
Yeah?
When I'm my own code, when I'm writing something from scratch, anything that exists has a unit test and
yeah,
the interface description. And if I find I'm heading for copy-paste, it's easy to fix it.
Yes, exactly. That's, and I want to share the awareness for it, that you have to look for it, that what it does to you. I mean, you see it only in old code. And my time is up. I thank you for your patience, your attention.